good afternoon to all of you. On behalf of TCS ION, I, Mudita Bansal, welcome you all to this webinar on outcome-based education. A very interesting topic, outcome-based education is a learning and teaching strategy which endeavors to promote active learning by giving the control of the process to the learner. This formulates content around activities that lead to specific outcomes. It directly leads to increasing the proficiency of a particular skill, knowledge, or behavior of the student. An OBE curriculum means starting with a clear picture of what is important for students to be able to do, then organizing the curriculum, instruction, and assessment to make sure this learning ultimately happens. Outcome-based education, without an iota of doubt, is a rival against the conservative idea of teaching and learning. It is a competency-based education which got blown up with the help of progressive educators who got a good grip of it. Today, outcome-based education is a firestorm with a great clarity of focus. It has embedded into learning to match up with the country's curriculum standards. Institutions are adopting and implementing OBE on a massive scale. It is my pleasure and an honor to welcome our guest speaker today, Mrs. Pramani Chopra. Mrs. Chopra is the principal of SETH MR Jaipuria School. She passed her ISC examination with a distinction in biology, completed her education from IT College with a distinction in chemistry and biology. She was awarded grade A in Masters in English by Allahabad Agricultural Institute. She joined Jaipuria Schools in 1992 and has worked in different hierarchical positions in the last 26 years in the school before becoming the principal in 2015. She has been conferred with Education Warrior Award by Deputy Chief Minister Mr. Dinesh Sharma. The event was organized by the Times of India for championing the new normal in education in the time of COVID pandemic to felicitate the teachers and institutes. I will repeat this line. She has been conferred with Education Award. She has been conferred with Education Warrior Award by Deputy Chief Minister Mr. Dinesh Sharma. The event was organized by the Times of India for championing the new normal in education in the time of COVID pandemic to felicitate teachers and institutes. Under her leadership, the school has been ranked number one in the country for encouraging student-led community service projects. And the school has also been given recognition from the Indian Army for the campaign Letters to Our Heroes, wherein the students were encouraged to write letters, pen poems, make paintings, and record videos for the armed forces. The school's efforts were acknowledged and appreciated. Ma'am, can you go on mute? Acknowledged and appreciated by the commanding officer of the Light Air Defense Regiment in The school's efforts were acknowledged and appreciated by the commanding officer of the Light Air Defense Regiment in Kashmir with a certificate of appreciation for the principal for nation building. She believes in constructive classroom teaching to satiate multiple intelligences. She is an avid reader, a passionate teacher, and believes that all knowledge is within. She draws inspiration from the Mother Nature. Welcome, Pramani ma'am.
Thank you so much, Mudita, for all the good words. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. So we'll open the talk by asking you, ma'am, how would you like to explain what is outcome-based education and what is its significance?
See, basically, outcome-based education, it centers around predefined goals. And you can call them outcomes. So by the end of the educational experience, each student is expected to have achieved that goal. Now, here it is more of experiential learning rather than giving information to the students, which is done in the traditional method. If we look at our country, And we can look at its significance with relevance to our country. Perhaps it will make it very easy for us to understand then. When we hire people, we know that they have grades. We know that they have marks, but they are not employable. So probably because they have gone through a process of education which has given them marks, they understood the outcome as marks, getting grades. But actual outcome is that which helps you to find the kind of employment you are looking at, and also to be able to use that to take forward that dream that you have, that aspiration that you have for yourself. So outcome-based education makes you more relevant to the society, gives you life skills rather than just giving you marks which may not help you to realize all your aspirations. For example, if we look at the corona times, we had so many advisories, eat this, eat that, and then handle yourself like this, wash your hands. So much of information was all around us. But we have to understand what was the outcome. The outcome was that the country had to keep itself safe, right? So based on that, people took the information. Based on that, people had to understand that so much of advisory is there, but the outcome is that we have to follow that regime which keeps us safe, which keeps the country safe. Whatever advisories had been given, the outcome was that India proved to be much ahead of other countries when it came to management of corona. So we based all the information that we were giving, the outcome was keep the country safe. Let us not go the way which other countries may be following. So why did people get into home remedies? Why did people start washing their hands? Why did the country become more hygienically inclined? Everybody got to do this because they wanted the outcome of keeping ourselves safe. So it's a life skill which we've given to people. So the outcome-based learning, I will put it this way, that it gives you life skills to manage your life well when you're out of the schools and colleges.
So simply you've put it, ma'am. Thank you so much for the clarity that you've given. So I think our viewers would also like to know how outcome-based education is different from traditional teaching of one teacher teaching a class full of students, 40, 45.
You see, it's like traditional teaching is one size fits all. And that one size fits all is basically there is a set syllabus. You have to follow that. You have to follow certain guidelines. Primarily, it is more of information that is given to the children. It is not analysis of the information that we stress on. Take the information, solve the questions. Even the so-called application questions are the ones which are given in the books as questions and answers. So they have nothing to do with your life skills. They are not related to your life. They are not related to any profession into which you need to go. So that is what it is. We believe that nothing can actually be taught. If we go to our past as students, we took from the teachers when we wanted to take it. So actually, we are learners. So if we are learners, then the teacher just needs to give us some set of information and we learn from it on our own, rather than the teacher telling us that, okay, this is the question, this is what you have to learn, you have to reproduce and you get the marks. So that is how it is different from traditional teaching. It is not one size fits all. The outcome is there. The child has to reach a certain stage, but he reaches that stage his way. The teacher has fixed that this is the problem that you need to solve. How you arrive at the solution is something that you need to think. The certain steps that you have to follow, this is for you to choose. The teacher does not tell you the steps. The teacher facilitates. The teacher is there to help when the child is stuck. But the steps are decided by the child. the problem and solution. Otherwise, the question and the answer both are provided by the teacher. So eventually, where is the learning? It is the learning of the teacher. It is not the learning of the child.
Sure, well understood, ma'am. So how do these teachers that you talk about, how do they facilitate the outcome-based education in a classroom? And what it takes to implement an outcome-based framework?
Yeah, so when you have to deliver an outcome-based, deliver things from and through an outcome-based approach, then first of all, you need to have facilitators who are trained to do that. They know what to say and when to leave and expect the child to speak. It is not that the teacher continues to speak and the child is not expressing his opinion. So when you prepare the module for an outcome-based learning, you have to first of all identify the skill. For example, if we are looking at empathy. Now, one way is that we tell them a story and you say that this is the story on empathy or this is the story on sympathy, if we talk of both empathy and sympathy. And now you do this question answer. So you've learned that it is essential to be empathetic, it is essential to be sympathetic. This is one. Now, the other approach is that the teacher tells every child that, look, we need to understand empathy. We need to understand what is sympathy. So let us first research, get into research, and all of us come together tomorrow to talk about it. And when all the children talk about it, from there, certain ideas are picked up by the children, and they from there formulate what they understand by empathy and sympathy. And then the step two goes on. How can you be empathetic, or what did you do yesterday to show your empathy towards someone? Is there anything that you did in this last week which shows that you are really empathetic? So the child comes up with things that he has done, analyzes himself, and then speaks about them in the class. And then the entire class appreciates each other and they know these are the ways we can be empathetic. It could be simply in the online times, parents had a lot to do at home. Now, if the school gave them some work, it was the responsibility of the child to do that on his own or to wait for the parent to get after him. The parents already had a role. So children who were thrown into this, they just see where you were empathetic last week. So probably there the child can come up with an answer. You see, my mother had her household chores to do. She had a younger sibling to manage, and the entire week I managed my classes on my own. I didn't go to my mother for it. And my mother appreciated me. So, you know, I was empathetic because I stepped into her shoes and I realized how much she has on her plate already. So, here you have given him a training for life to feel for people whenever you see them around you. So, it's not about doing an English literature lesson where you are talking of empathy and then you are giving marks for questions on empathy and answers on sympathy. So this is what I mean. But for this, teachers have to actually think about what kind of work has to be given to the child. And each time, marks need not be there. They could be simply comments. They could be comments from their peers. They could be just comments from their parents. So the child also learns how to give a feedback about something that people have done. So you reach a higher outcome. You make the child a better person rather than doing the getting into the question answer. And this applies to all the subjects. I feel it applies to all the subjects. Like, for example, you have maths. If you talk of happiness, if you're taking addition, then you can tell the children, okay, in which concept of life do you apply addition? Just think. So when the child starts thinking, it is, well, I was happy. I shared my happiness with my friends. And you know, it added to my happiness. So here the mathematical concept is applied to happiness as well. So that's how you construct a particular skill, a particular idea.
I like that that example that you talked about, feedback. So the child learns to assess as well, ma'am. So that is another takeaway I see from here. That's a beautiful concept. Thank you. So we'll talk more about the child, the student here. How does the child feel about this teaching process now that you've been imparting the process, applying the process on your students for quite long now? So how does the child feel about the process, and how do the teachers at Jaipuria School provide the learning feedback and map the learning outcomes of the students?
So you see, we call ourselves a school of conscious transformation. Now, if we look at it, then we understand, I would prefer taking recent examples. So in the present pandemic, if we did not have the capability to transform ourselves, if teachers didn't have the capability to transform themselves, would we have given any education to children? Schools were not there in space, but they were very much there. If parents did not want to transform themselves, they would not have provided these facilities at home. They would have shunned them. But those who provided and those who supported the teachers, they transformed themselves, they transformed their children as well. So learning continued. Now herein, when it comes to teachers, when it comes to our school, we do quite a lot of projects. They are not projects which are like you write something and it is a file that you make. It's not like that. For example, there is a project which says self-transformation project. Now this is done by my grade 8 students, wherein they pick up something in their personality. It could be simply they are adolescents. So you know, at this age, they enter into little arguments with their parents and they feel that they're spoiling their relations. So the child could simply say, how can I improve my relationship with my parent? Or how can I learn good things, or how can I learn cooking from my grandmother? I've not been doing it, but I want to do it. Or simply, how can I become a better person, or how can I change my perspective towards life? So then, after taking this project, the child works at it. For 3 months, the child works at it and comes back to us saying that this is the transformation, this has happened in me. I spoke to my mother, and I promise that every day both of us will sit down and read a story. And then step two that I took, I will not, whenever there is a difference in opinion, I will withdraw from there and keep quiet for 5 minutes. So initially it didn't happen, and it took me of 1 month to understand it was not that easy. And then gradually my arguments, I started controlling myself. In 1 week, I managed to control myself 4 times. So I felt better. Next month, I controlled myself even more. So gradually, my mother started appreciating. We started spending more time with each other. We understood each other and we started talking to find solutions to my problems. And that is how my relation improved. And then the child takes the mother's interview. The child even puts himself over there. Eventually the child comes, presents that project in front of the parent, in front of his own classmates. Then the classmates evaluate that project. They give marks to the child on that project. A parent gives, so a peer and a parent evaluate that, yes, you have managed to bring about a change in yourself, and then tell us after 2 months, how are you feeling about it? So it is a two-pronged approach. One, the child who's working upon himself. Now it is such a big outcome through the project that you manage to improve your relation with the parent. You manage to respect your parent a little more. This is one. And second thing is that as peers, all of you are evaluating each other's project. So you learn to look at the virtues in each other rather than criticizing each other. So you remove negativity from your own being as well. Eventually, once you start appreciating people, you start looking at yourself, understanding your deficiencies. So you've done two things. What more do you want? You've created so much for yourself by transforming yourself. And at the same time, when you are evaluating someone, you are looking at the pluses rather than the minuses. So you imagine what a beautiful place the world is going to be if we look at such outcomes. So this is a project we do in class 8. Similarly, we do projects in class 7 like body interaction. We do a responsible and conscious citizenship project in grade 5, where the child goes around the city and he finds a place, like it could be simply a milk factory, and he sees what should be the ideal one and what is over there. He makes a presentation on that, goes to the people over there, talks to them, appreciates them for all the virtues in that area, and then comes back to tell them, you know, if these things could also be there, if you could put just a logbook where people could write their experiences, or if you could make milk of different flavors, that'll also be nice. So this is perceiving a problem, analyzing it, finding a solution, but going back to the other person without negativity, going back, approaching him, first appreciating and then giving the suggestion. So that's how we do it in the school in grades 5 to 9. And in the lower grades, we do the entire thing is skill based. We do every skill through all the subjects. So we look at values and we do value teaching also through all the subjects, as I told you about addition, similarly through subtraction, application skills, collaboration, that is also a skill, appreciation, that is also a skill. So that way we've made our report card as well. It doesn't reflect all marks.
And what about the learning feedback? And learning feedback, we have covered MAP learning outcomes. I think that part is left on some.
Yeah. So you see, you have to map learning outcomes. You're throwing a challenge at a child that you have to do this project and you have to present it. Now, there are different stages of the project. So different stages, there is a timeline. So how does the teacher map the learning outcome? The teacher looks at the first step and she sees whether the child has met the timeline or not. If he hasn't met, then she checks the child for that. And the child knows that I have to do the project, but I have to do it, adhere to the time schedule. First step, the child doesn't adhere to the time schedule. So he's given some time, but there is a remark. The teacher gives the remark and the child himself sees everyone else has done, I haven't done. So there is a mark component associated over there. But that mark component is not for doing what you're doing, but for adhering to the time limit. So it's not a mark component based on question and answer. It's a mark component which is looking at your attitude towards your work. So we are marking them on the basis of their attitude to work, the outcome, and not giving marks on memorization of information which has been given, which is already there. Where is that information going to take you when you already have it at the click of a button? So
agree, ma'am. So attitude definitely is a very important aspect. Even in corporates, we before we hire a person, definitely our attitude is one primary point to focus upon. So building it from the very beginning in a child will definitely make him a good human being and a recruitable human being.
Absolutely. So that is why, you know, in our report card, we say peer learning and we say collaborative learning. So when it's collaborative learning, you're talking of outcomes. So the teacher gives them a topic of discussion and she is just a silent observer. She observes them from a distance to see which child is leading the group, which child is there who's expressing his opinion in a manner that he's taking everyone with him, and who's the child who's being left behind. So what has to be done for the child who's being left behind? And who's the person in the group who's not leaving anyone behind and urging him to speak? So these are the observations, these are anecdotal reports which the teachers make. So it's not marks, it's the anecdotal report. And then accordingly, we work with that child.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, ma'am. It takes us to our next question. How shall the teachers go about the curriculum and instructional design for outcome-based education experience? And how long does it take to create an outcome-based education lesson?
You see, for every subject and for every grade, many times it may not be possible, right? For example, when we look at maths, so if the grades are a higher, I mean, if the children are in grade 9 and 10, then we cannot look at everything with respect to outcomes in mathematics, because we have constraints. We all know that they have to adhere to a certain set of things which are associated with whichever board with which you are associated. But up to grade 7, there is a lot of flexibility, and we do have our textbooks, but from those textbooks we pick up lessons, we call out lessons with which we can associate any skill. So as I told you, skills could be application, skill could be analysis, skill could be comprehension, it could be empathy, some of the value-based skills. In each term, you give a different value to the teacher. You give a different value to the class, so that all the values which are essential for you to develop into a human being are handled by the teacher through different subjects. Similarly, so that is what we do. It's not that we leave the curriculum behind. We do incorporate all the lessons. It is just that the teacher teaches them, keeping in mind the skill she has to do, keeping in mind the outcome she wants. So it is like, supposing you are doing a literature lesson, and it is not that you are looking at the entire literature lesson in the form of question answers, if there is some character in the lesson. So we say, okay, in this lesson, we are only looking at character analysis. Now at the back of your mind, you have this, that the outcome is that the child should become observant. The child should be able to elaborate on the person who's in front of him and take this life skill to his actual life when he grows. So the child looks at every detail of the character. Supposing it is some lesson which is mentioning the character of Hanuman. So now the child can describe everything with relevant to that. He can pick up everything from the lesson. But when the teacher gives him a question, it is not about Hanumanji. It is about some other character which the child has learned or picked up through a cartoon. Or it is a character which the child has seen at home. So you say, okay, now you describe a character from any story or from your life which influences you the most. So first you have to describe the physical aspect of the character, then you have to describe the other aspects of the character which influence you. Now, as the child grows, he understands that there will be aspects in everyone's character which I may not like, but I have to accept them and I have to analyze the other things which are more prominent in the character. So you began from the lesson and you eventually came to the outcome of character analysis, but you did not make the child memorize them. You allowed him to pick them up from his surroundings. So curriculum is also done, because when you come talk of English, it's about vocabulary, it's about sentence building. When you are doing all that in character analysis, all that is already in place. Rather than asking the child, okay, now you learn the words and learn the meanings, then from where does a child go from there? What does he do with those words and meanings? They're just left with him as pieces of information. Here, he uses those words to analyze, to put them briefly together. So like that, we take all the similarly collaboration I've already told you. So this is the skill-based thing that we do through the curriculum, which is there. Now, when it comes to higher grades, like grade 6, 7, 8, if we are doing physics or if we are doing chemistry, then we assign a portion of the mark component to memorization, because memorization of facts is also essential. But some weightage is given to application-based questions. Some weightage is given to analysis-based questions. So that's how we build the curriculum to, you know, have this outcome-based learning. Because if a child is studying light and he doesn't know what white light is and what is the role of white light in the environment, then he's simply learning physics in the book, but he's not applying it. He's not looking at the colors of the rainbow and picking up a scale and seeing, okay, through the scale also I can see the colors of a rainbow, and I can utilize this knowledge when I make some sunglasses. So there are aspects to it which are done by the teachers and the students. But we don't
leave the interesting. Sorry, please go ahead.
No. So we do take care of the curriculum and we manage to finish the syllabus. It's not that we don't manage to finish the syllabus.
Sure. Thank you for the lovely examples that you picked from the nature, ma'am. So how is it mandatory for a teacher to be trained on outcome-based education to be able to teach in educational institutes?
Yes, of course. It's very essential because it's a big shift. You see, the kind of education I went through when I was small, the kind of education my teachers have gone through was very, very traditional. So it is like, I am teaching you, you have to listen to me and you have to write just this. Otherwise, it doesn't fetch you marks. Now, this is a big shift. You can't do this in outcome-based learning. So first of all, the teachers have to convince themselves that that traditional method will not give my students the kind of a platform I want them to go up to. I have to give them ways to speak, to express their opinion. So I have to give them some facts. And after giving the facts, I say, okay, now you study the facts. Come to me with your opinion based on these facts. This question is based on these facts, but I want each one of you to give your opinion. So here the teacher has to accept divergent views, because we are asking somebody, okay, you express your opinion by about the ways the government handled the pandemic. So everybody's opinion is good. Now there the teacher can't be opinionated. She can't be biased. She cannot say, yes, your opinion is right or your opinion is wrong. She says, okay, I accept everyone's opinion, and eventually we come at a collaboration. And I'm enumerating all the opinions, and today I learn from you all. So for all that, you understand from where the teacher has to, she has to come down from her pedestal and she has to be with that entire group. So it's a big shift in the teacher's psychology. It's a lot of work on the part of the teacher, because she has to make her teaching interesting, but at the same time within a certain framework, so that it does not diversify to that extent that the class loses direction. So you have to, the teacher has to be very clear in her mind, where am I taking these children? If I'm talking of character analysis, the child is giving his opinion about 20 other things. I say, okay, that's fine. But today's class, we talk about this without being rude. So the teacher has to become a real facilitator, understand at each moment, I have to respect their opinion, but I cannot allow them to move out or digress from the point at hand, because that is also a skill. Talking about points at hand is also a skill which the children need to know. So a lot of training on the part of the teacher is essential. Lot of patience is needed. It's so easy to impart instruction and get the answers. You need a lot of patience, you need a lot of energy when you have to accept different views.
Ma'am, would you like to add how you're doing this training for the teachers?
Yeah, so it is like not a training only in curriculum. We have different levels of hierarchy through which we do that. But it is a temperamental shift also, which is essential. Because you see, when the children will get into outcome-based learning, the classes will not always be quiet. There will be times when all of them are energetic and they've involved themselves into that activity. Sometimes it may seem chaotic to the teacher. So she has to find a way to put order in that class, also to sort herself out. So in our school, teachers, they go every year, we junior school teachers, we send them to Pondicherry, where they train themselves on integral education. So four teachers go over there, they train them. And then we also invite speakers from there so that they can train the teachers in school. Now these trainings are basically to make the teacher understand that nothing can be taught. You have to move from near to far. So it's not that you give a high flying concept to the child and he doesn't know the basics. Basics are in the information. But from that information, where do you want to take the child? What is the application you want to bring about through that information? Then nothing can be taught means you have to not be telling the child, you just listen to me and do only this. what are the views of the child, frame questions so that you are able to understand the views of the child, so that the child is hooked on to learning. It's not that he gets bored. Nothing is boring for him. So these two concepts, plus development of patience, controlling the class without making the children feel that you are controlling them, doing projects, all this training is given by the speakers who come from Pondicherry Ashram. Then we have our academic heads, coordinators, who keep looking at the curriculum and who bring about the changes, who keep adding skills, who keep pruning it. Whatever we found was not relevant, we remove that. Whatever we find is relevant, whatever innovations can be done, we have teams in the school to do it.
Excellent, thank you. So we've actually come to an end of the session, such an insightful session it was. If you would like to share any closing remarks for the audience, ma'am.
My closing remarks are that all education is within. And it is good if we try to make the child connect with himself by appreciating himself. The child has to have this faith and that I can resolve every issue. It is just that I need the strength to do it. And for that, the skills that are there in my education, I must utilize those skills for the benefit of all. All this is very important, and very important for teachers to understand that the child is the ultimate perfectionist, but we have to allow the child to find that perfection within him by not imposing ourselves.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was such an engaging talk that you gave to us. It was a pleasure being with you today. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much. Pleasure for me.